got lost in his own museum, huh?
Uh-huh.
After you, Junior.
Yes, sir.
On BBC Choice.
3, 2, 1, go!
Hey, Chris, show me your breast!
Very becoming.
Rock on! Have you ever ridden the Strider torpedo?
You've gone bonkers. You're mad.
I got my eye on you.
The game show that needs no introduction.
Truly takes the cake.
Sublime.
Yeah.
New Shooting Star, the BBC Choice premiere continues Sunday at 9.
Heartrending.
If you don't move away from me and sit down and listen, I'm gonna walk from
head turning.
Too good to be going out with a bunch of women.
Mind blowing.
It is a she and she's not a bird.
Award winning drama.
Okay, easy, Tiger.
8 extraordinary stories.
Don't like this life.
Change it. People do it all the time.
Clocking On. A brand new series starts next Thursday at 9 on BBC One.
On Question Time tonight, a panel famous for blunt speaking. Labour's Chief Whip, Hilary Armstrong. Shadow Treasury Chief Secretary, John Bercow. Broadcaster and writer, Muriel Gray. Genetics expert and campaigner, Dr. Tom Shakespeare. And Sandy Miller, founder of the Christian Alpha Course. Join us for Question Time from Sunderland on BBC One after the news.
This is BBC One Southwest. Time now for the BBC News at 10 o'clock. Presented by Michael Burke with John Maguire.
The politicians are at war tonight over a 94-year-old hospital patient. Lies and smears in the row over Rose Addis and the health service. Today's rail strikes in the north will roll south. The trains won't. Ryanair, the big budget airline. It's ordering up to 150 new aircraft.
The referee's whistle goes for the end of the game.
And the voice of rugby, Bill McLaren, is stepping down from the commentary box.
Here in the southwest, a new Devon town with thousands of new homes is to be built on the South Ham's green fields. And a Walker has been swept into the sea off Tintagel. An air and sea search has been called off.
Good evening. The hospital treatment of a 94-year-old woman has provoked the bitterest row in British politics since the last election. The Conservative leader, Ian Duncan Smith, has accused ministers of lying about the case of Rose Addis and smearing her family. Tony Blair has been defending the doctors and nurses at the hospital. The medical director there became embroiled tonight, with the Tories questioning his links with the Labour Party. Andrew Marr's at Westminster. Andrew.
Is the NHS rubbish and getting worse, or is it pretty good and getting better? If that's the question that most of us would like answered, what we've learned today is that you can't separate politics, even down and dirty politics, from the National Health Service.
An ordinary family in the eye of a bitter national row. The daughter and grandson of Mrs. Rose Addis, 94, whose care at the Whittington Hospital in North London was raised by the Tory leader in the Commons, are now talking to the hospital managers. But they're aghast at the ferocity of what a simple complaint about one old woman's treatment has produced.
My mother went to Ian Duncan Smith because he is her constituency MP. The fact he is the leader of the opposition has made it into a thunderous political game.
Thunderous is right, but Ian Duncan Smith isn't backing down. He is livid about what he sees as the bullying of a family whose case he raised only because the government was brushing it aside.
If people can't complain, if people can't say help, without the government and the bureaucracy dumping down on top of them, smearing them, accusing this woman of being a racist is outrageous, and also about her daughter not getting there. I mean, all these smears are just appalling. These are ordinary people with the whole machinery of government and the bureaucracy down on their necks. Someone has to stand up for them, and I'm going to do it.
The government is now backing unhappily away from detailed discussion of this case, but from the Prime Minister and his Health Secretary today, we've seen a steadily more aggressive defence of the NHS in general.
Now, look, it's fair game in politics to smear people like me. What is not fair game is to smear people who come to work. We don't pay them a fortune. They come to work to care for people and treat people well, not maltreat them. The NHS is full of good people, not bad ones, and we ought to be on their side.
That message, at least, is welcomed by staff at the Whittington Hospital.
We like to investigate our complaints in an open arena, but the problem at the moment is it's actually detrimental to staff morale in terms of it's producing a certain amount of anxiety for patients that are coming to the hospital expecting a high delivery of service care, and obviously they're coming with preconceived ideas of things that they might have read or seen in the papers.
But on this political grid, nothing is quite as it seems. Tonight, it's emerged that James Malone Lee, the same professor who led the defence of the hospital, is himself a Labour Party member of 20 years standing. So what, he says. But he's accused by the Tories of being a Labour stooge. The misfortune of Rose Addis is not a political football, political punch-up, more like. One she began accidentally, but one now so savage that no accident and emergency department in the country would be able to deal with the consequences.
This is an extraordinary business, isn't it, Andrew? It's kind of politics by proxy.
Yes, I guess you could say that. It is interesting that none of the politicians want to speak, as it were, for themselves. The Conservatives in this are saying we are the voice of the downtrodden patients, and anything which challenges the veracity of any of those stories undermines them. And the Labour Party is saying, we're not speaking as ministers or the government, we're speaking on behalf of the ordinary doctors and nurses who are so put upon themselves, which is why this revelation about Professor Berners-Lee is so difficult for them this evening. It tends to undermine or undercut that authority. And I guess the odd thing about all of this is that for all the heat and the anger here at Westminster, most people in the end will not judge these matters by what they see on television or what politicians say to them, but by the experiences of themselves and their families.
Andrew, thanks. Social Affairs editor Neil Dixon is at the Whittington Hospital in North London. Neil, these cases are notoriously difficult to establish the objective truth, but as far as we can tell, was this old lady treated properly?
I think the honest answer to that question, do we know what actually happened to Rose Addis here at this hospital during her time at the accident and emergency department and afterwards? And the answer is no, we do not, and neither do the politicians who've simply chosen to believe the version of events that suits them. I think what one can say, because everyone is agreed on this, is that her first 2.5 days here, where she was 94 years old, she was left in her same clothes during the whole of that period, that was not satisfactory care. The question is, could the staff have done more? They would say no. Could the relatives have done more? Could they have appeared and helped earlier than they did? Those questions are simply alternative versions of events which we don't have. But I think everyone is agreed that she didn't get the best possible care during that period.
So how typical is this case and this hospital?
Well, this hospital, in one sense, is not typical. The accident and emergency department here has a rather better record than some others in London. The overall position of accident and emergency departments across the country, though, is quite depressing. The fact is that patients wait too long for treatment, often, and many patients wait far too long to find a bed when they have been treated in these accident and emergency departments. Most people would now accept that the National Health Service simply doesn't have the capacity to treat. There may be management problems, and there are some departments that appear to perform better than others with the same resources. But there does seem to be a shortage of doctors and nurses to do the job, which people keep saying. The problem is that the government has raised expectations. Now it's got to raise the NHS game, and the question is whether it can do that in time.
Neil, thanks. There was more misery for rail passengers today as a 48-hour strike on Arriva Trains Northern forced it to cancel over 1,400 of its 1,600 daily services. Arriva operates trains across the north of England. A two-day strike is also planned on South West trains next week, and industrial action could soon spread further. Strike ballots have been called on ScotRail, on Silverlink and the London Underground and Docklands Light Railway. Transport correspondent Simon Montague reports.
Leeds City Station this evening, heart of the Arriva network. But tonight, hardly any trains are running, and pure frustration for the few trying to get home.
I just think it's pathetic, it's just not on. It's a Thursday night and everyone wants to get home. Tomorrow's Friday and that's the last day of working days. And this is absolutely not on.
Everyone's trying to get to where they're going, working places, and they can't get a train. It's disgusting.
The cause of it all, RMT members on strike. Train conductors want a higher pay rise to match the one just given to train drivers.
The conductors are asking only for parity with that pay award, not the same pay as some people would have you believe, but parity, and this has been denied them.
Arriva's short of dozens of drivers. It's given them 17.6% to stop any more leaving the company. But the conductors are being offered only 8%. The company says their claim for a much bigger rise isn't justified.
The driver is fully responsible for the safety of the train that they drive. It takes us 12 months to train them to make sure that they don't drive a train unsafely. The conductors also get safety responsibilities for the passengers on the train and for opening and closing power doors. But it only takes 8 weeks to train them. There's a big differential between the jobs.
I think it's only fair that if we pay our money, you should give us a proper service. So does it too.
Arriva's facing not just the anger of conductors, but customers as well. More than 100 passengers gathered in a Harrogate hotel tonight to confront the company over months of poor service caused by driver shortages. Arriva's customers face another strike tomorrow. Passengers on other train companies could soon be facing similar stoppages. So what is behind all these disputes? Well, the unions insist they're all about issues of pay. But there are others that think it's really about the battle for the leadership of the RMT union itself, and about the candidates for leadership wanting to demonstrate their industrial muscle. Simon Montague, BBC News at Leeds Station.
Britain's leading aid agencies have launched an appeal for the Democratic Republic of Congo. Around 100,000 people have been made homeless by the country's volcanic eruption, and many face starvation and disease. As relief efforts gather pace, scientists are warning that Mount Nyiragongo remains unstable and could erupt again. Special correspondent Ben Brown reports.
Goma lies in the shadow of not one but two volcanoes. Their craters are a brooding menace to this town. But Mount Nyiragongo is the monster that has killed, maimed and left 100,000 people homeless. Today, a group of international experts flew over her and got their first good look at the volcano, whose lava flows have raced through the jungle towards Goma. These scientists are worried by continuing earth tremors they cannot explain, and by huge cracks that have opened up just outside Goma, putting the people here in real danger.
Goma has been built just beneath a very dangerous volcano. So the threat is always there. Now it's over. maybe this activity is over, so also the seismic activity will not be a major threat in few years, or even few months, or even several years. If it's not correctly monitored, they may be in danger again.
In Goma, people have to walk on solidified lava, while just a few inches below their feet, the flames are still burning.
More than a third of the town has been destroyed by these vast lava flows. And the question now is, should Goma be rebuilt? Some experts think not. They're asking, is it right to have a settlement of some 500,000 people so close to such a dangerous volcano?
Local scientists test the temperature of the lava. They warned just before the disaster that an eruption was imminent. They asked the United Nations for money to monitor the volcano. It never came. But that's academic now for the people of Goma, scavenging for what's left of this town, even just a few rusty nails, anything with which to start rebuilding their homes and their lives. Ben Brown, BBC News, Goma.
The United States Congress has begun investigations into the collapse of the giant American energy company Enron. The session ran into immediate problems when the company's former auditor from the Arthur Andersen Partnership refused to testify about the shredding of company documents. Enron's become the biggest bankruptcy in American history. From Washington, Stephen Sacker.
It's scandal time in Washington.
The hearing will come to order.
Enron, one of America's biggest companies, crashed, and Congress wants to know who's to blame.
You swear that you will tell the testimony you will give this committee is the truth.
First in the firing line, David Duncan, executive with accountants Arthur Andersen. He supervised Enron's books. He also happens to have shredded thousands of valuable documents concerning Enron's finances.
Enron robbed the bank. Arthur Andersen provided the getaway car. And they say you were at the wheel.
After that opening thrust, the killer question.
Did you give an order to destroy documents in an attempt to subvert governmental investigations?
On the advice of my counsel, I respectfully declined to answer the question based on the protection afforded me under the Constitution of the United States.
Next question came, same answer. Clearly, Mr. Duncan wasn't going to talk.
I'm disappointed to hear that.
Others did talk, though, including one Arthur Andersen executive who confirmed there had been wholesale shredding as the Enron scandal closed in.
After that meeting, an extensive document destruction and email removal process resulted.
These hearings will go on for weeks, but the sense of outrage is already obvious.
If crimes have been committed, it is my fervent hope that those responsible will see the inside of a jail cell.
Chilling words, perhaps, for this man, Ken Lay, Enron boss and longtime financial backer of President Bush. He's just resigned. The paper trail, or shredded paper trail, is being investigated by the FBI as well as Congress. It could all get very messy. This congressional investigation could have far-reaching consequences for all of corporate America. Enron and Arthur Andersen say they stayed within the rules that govern American business. True or not, many people here now believe those rules need changing. Stephen Sacker, BBC News, Washington.
With me is our business editor, Jeff Randall. Jeff, from our point of view, what makes this more than just a big American company going bust in a rather shady way?
Well, it's much bigger than that, Michael. It really is. This is destined to become Enrongate, in my view, the corporate equivalent of Watergate, and not just because of the shredding. Clearly, the company Enron is on trial, and Andersen, its auditors are on trial. But, you know, really, it's a much bigger picture than that. The world's accounting systems are now on trial. We're not talking about some Mickey Mouse company here from the back of beyond. This was Andersen's, one of the big five, and we are entitled to believe what they say. Professional investors around the world are going to be looking at their numbers now and saying, we've got investments. Can we believe the numbers? Can we believe what the auditors say? Or are, as one Republican said today, just hocus-pocus accounting?
So who's in the firing line?
Well, I can tell you who the Democrats want to be in the firing line. They want the firing line to go all the way to the White House. I saw those Democrat congressmen today and they had fire in their eyes. They've got a Republican scandal and they believe that they've really got something here. They look like dogs chasing a fox and they think the fox is going to leave them, lead them to the Oval Office. One senior US businessman said to me tonight, there are skeletons in that cupboard and we're going to shake them till the bones come out.
Jeff, thanks very much. Northern Ireland's most senior policeman has been meeting relatives of the victims of the Omagh bombing. Sir Ronnie Flanagan rejects the police ombudsman's report that there was a failure of leadership during the investigation, but admitted that errors had been made. He was asked if the inquiry was as thorough as it should have been.
Absolutely not. How could anybody ever say that? Of course there were mistakes made, of course there were errors, and of course there are things that we could have done better and could have done differently. What I can say is that none of those errors, none of those shortcomings have led to any diminution in the prospects of bringing people to justice.
An American man captured by American forces in Afghanistan has appeared in a United States court. John Walker-Lindt, a 20-year-old Californian, is accused of conspiring to kill Americans and of helping al-Qaeda terrorists. His family say he's innocent.
Back on American soil in the grip of the FBI, American Taliban John Walker-Lindt, shackled hand and foot. He's returned to face charges of conspiring to kill Americans and of providing support for the al-Qaeda network. If found guilty, he'll face the rest of his life in prison. His story has bewildered the country, a 20-year-old Taliban soldier determined, it's alleged, to fight a holy war against his countrymen. But a very different young man appeared in court, his hair closely cropped, his beard shaven off. Asked if he understood the charges leveled against him, his reply was almost sheepish. Yes, he said, I do. Thank you.
We're very grateful.
His parents were at the courthouse, the first time they'd seen their son since his Taliban adventure began.
John loves America. We love America. John did not do anything against America. John did not take up arms against America. He never meant to harm any American, and he never did harm any American.
But at least their son got his day in court, which there's no guarantee of for the three Britons held on Guantanamo Bay. The Foreign Secretary said he'd prefer to see them tried in Britain, but it's the Americans who'll decide. Nick Brandt, BBC News, Washington.
A former Lebanese Christian militia leader, blamed for the massacres of Palestinian refugees in Beirut 20 years ago, has been killed by a car bomb. Eli Hobeka and three bodyguards died in the explosion in Beirut. Israel has denied any involvement.
Eli Hobeka died as he'd lived. The man accused of murdering hundreds was himself killed in a massive car bomb attack. There were many in Lebanon who'd like to have seen Hobeka dead. The Lebanese government didn't wait for an inquiry, but immediately blamed Israel.
I think Israel, and Sharon in particular, is behind it, because Hobeka had evidence of the involvement of Sharon in the Sabra and Shatila massacres.
Just 2 days ago, Hobeka confirmed he would testify before a Belgian court investigating Mr. Sharon's role in the massacres. These last pictures of Hobeka were filmed by a Belgian politician who says the timing of the murder is puzzling.
His role in politics was minimal at the moment. He was not elected. He was isolated. And if they would have killed him, they could have killed him for the last 10 years. So why now exactly?
Eli Hobeka became notorious when he led his Christian militia into the Palestinian camps of Sabra and Shatila in 1982. His men were allowed in by Israel's Defense Minister Ariel Sharon, who wanted them to root out Palestinian guerrillas. But what followed was an orgy of killing. When I secretly recorded Hobeka in Beirut, I put to him directly the charge that he was a war criminal.
You are a mass murderer who is lying to avoid being brought to justice.
Which justice?
International justice.
I'm not afraid of international justice.
Ariel Sharon has always said Hobeka and his men bear sole responsibility for the massacre. But an Israeli inquiry found Sharon indirectly responsible, and he was forced to step down as defense minister. Tonight, the man who is now Israel's prime minister emphatically denied any role in Hobeka's murder. We have no link to this subject at all, and this is not worthy of comment, he said. Eli Hobeka made many enemies. In his day, he worked for Israeli and Syrian intelligence. He was a man with many secrets. They've gone with him to the grave. Fergal Keane, BBC News.
Ryanair, the Irish low-cost airline, has placed an order to buy 100 new Boeing 737-800 aircraft, with options for a further 50 if required. It's the largest ever single order for the 737.
Slump in air travel? What slump? While the big carriers suffer, these queues at Stansted Airport are apparently normal.
Ryanair is pretty busy. They've kept their numbers up pretty high.
Ryanair needs 150 new planes because it believes passenger numbers are going to triple in a decade. Despite terrorist attacks, cheap tickets are prompting travellers to make trips they wouldn't have even thought of in the past. The low-cost airlines are all winning new business. Last year, Ryanair flew more than 7 million people, an increase of 34%. EasyJet carried 7.6 million, up 28%. And Go pulled in 4 million passengers, an extra 48%. Announcing today's order, Ryanair's chief executive Michael O'Leary insisted much of his company's growth was down to the number of passengers switching from more established airlines.
You'll never go back, because in reality, why would you want to waste that £250 for what? A free glass of champagne? And to be stuck in crowded airports like Heathrow and Charles de Gaulle? They don't go back.
And to make money, the new airlines follow the golden rules. When the plane's empty, sell the seats dirt cheap. When it's full, put the price up. When it's on the ground, get it back into the air as quickly as possible. They also fly into smaller airports for their cheaper landing charges and plentiful slots. EasyJet's just moved into Liverpool Airport.
The emergence of the low-cost carriers has completely turned the market upside down. And what they're looking for is an airport that can offer an efficiency of operation. The aircraft here can be turned around in 20 minutes.
In buying so many aircraft, Ryanair's Michael O'Leary is effectively placing a $9 billion bet that low-cost operators will, in 10 years' time, be as profitable as they are now. Tom Simons, BBC News, Stansted Airport.
Football and Aston Villa's manager John Gregory has resigned unexpectedly tonight after 4 years with the team. Villa, currently seventh in the Premiership, said Gregory wanted to take a break from soccer to consider his future.
So, another victim of the pressures of the Premiership. John Gregory's resignation was far from expected, but it seems Aston Villa's recent FA Cup defeat by Manchester United, after squandering a two-goal lead, ultimately proved the final straw. It's all a far cry from his arrival at Villa Park in 1998, in which Gregory led his side to the top of the Premiership and was touted as a future England manager. But although he guided Villa to the 2000 FA Cup final, major honours proved elusive, the focus more often on his volatile relationship with chairman Doug Ellis, notably over money for players. Ellis, though, described tonight's parting as amicable, saying Gregory wanted a break from the managerial strains. Certainly Villa are hardly struggling, a respectable seventh in the Premiership table, and so Gregory's surprise decision leaves many questions still to be answered. Andy Swiss, BBC News.
Bill McLaren, the BBC's voice of rugby union, is to retire. He first began broadcasting in 1952, and now, aged 79, he says his final international match will be Wales against Scotland in April. Daniela Ralph reports.
Oh, did he knock it forward? He may have done, but the referee didn't see it.
Bill McLaren has provided the commentary for virtually every big rugby production. He's been the voice of his sport.
Irvin, can he get to the line? Irvin, can he score?
You get a tremendous thrill out of the whole thing, and of course I'll miss it. It'll be awful. Not only that, but I'll have to do far more of washing and drying dishes and doing the blinking hoovering.
Scotland's victories have given him the greatest pleasure.
Danger could be there, first try.
And never more so when they were wins over England.
And Scotland have won a famous victory.
He displays passion and pride, and he would never know that he's really cheering for Scotland at the same time.
And for me, the first time I met him, I remember thinking, "Ah, that's the voice," you know, and he spoke to me, young Carling, and you're thinking, "Wow."
At times, though, the commentary did little to save a player's embarrassment.
Good thing he's got a long jersey. A splendid rear view.
Bill McLaren hangs up his mic for the last time later this year. Daniela Ralph, BBC News.
Right, it's 25 past 10. I'll be back a little later with an update on the day's headlines. But now we join our news teams across the UK.
Good evening. The South Hams in Devon is to get a new town with up to 3,500 homes. The announcement's been greeted with anger. The site will be the Sherford Valley between the A38 and Brixton. It'll be split into four village-style communities: Wiverton, East Sherford, West Sherford and Chittleburn. Samantha Smith reports.
The Sherford Valley is a buffer of farmland between Plymouth and its suburbs and the villages of the South Hams. The decision has surprised many and appalled those who've campaigned against a new town anywhere in this area. At a press briefing this morning, emotions ran high. This campaigner insisting he should see the plans today too, the council demanding them back.
Well, I'm sorry, you can't release it to the media and then say that the people who've got a comment on it can't even look at what it is.
They come tomorrow.
I'm sorry.
This is the latest in a long series of these developments where the public has been treated with utter contempt at every stage.
Selling the idea of a new settlement was never going to be easy, but council planners believe it's the best way of solving a difficult problem.
It'll have less impact on the surrounding countryside, it will have less impact on other people in the South Hams than the other alternatives, which would have been to have built large estates on the side of Plymouth or large estates on the side of our existing villages.
But in Brixton, just south of the proposed development, local people aren't reassured.
Hi Don, can I have £3 of the Seville oranges, please?
Yes, certainly.
I feel that Brixton will be completely swallowed and subsumed by it and will become just a dormitory of Plymouth. They've produced this wonderful vision of the future with all these open spaces and wonderful services, etc. And I believe that any developer would just look at it and say, well, that's very nice, but we can't actually afford to do that.
But new communities are being built, one here in Cambridgeshire, another's planned for East Devon. Environmentalists say they're out of tune with the government's stated policy to protect the countryside.
The planning system is changing very fast. The new guidance the government has asked to be implemented at once doesn't approve of new settlements for this sort of purpose, for solving urban problems next door.
And the future of this valley will only be decided after public consultation and, almost certainly, an inquiry.
A Walker has been swept into the sea off North Cornwall. An air and sea search has been called off tonight. The man was part of a group walking along a footpath at Rocky Valley near Tintagel. It comes 5 days after a man was swept out to sea in Newquay. Jane Chandler reports.
Searching for any trace of the missing man. He's believed to be a 31-year-old from Japan. He was walking along the Tintagel coast with a party of Japanese students. He was swept into the sea shortly before 1 o'clock today. A full search and rescue operation was mounted. It involved the rescue helicopter from Caldrose and the Padstow lifeboat. The rescue teams have combed the whole of the bay around Rocky Valley Head, where the student disappeared. They've also searched the shoreline 1 mile in either direction. The Coast Guard say his chances of survival are now very slim.
I think purely from being in the water itself, there are many, many examples of people surviving for quite long times. The problem that he does have is that given the conditions we have at the moment and the turbulence that's around, his danger is actually being hammered against the rocks.
This is the second time this week that someone has been swept out to sea. On Sunday, a 27-year-old man went into the water during an all-night party at Newquay. The search for him has now been called off.
There wasn't any stupidity going on either of the two incidents. I think it was just unfortunate that they happened to be taken off the rocks. And given that, then all I can just reiterate to people is that the sea is rough. The sea can be a dangerous place. Just take care.
This is where the Japanese student disappeared, at the bottom of Rocky Valley Head. The weather conditions here today have been utterly treacherous. Police are now interviewing his companions tonight to find out exactly what happened.
The future of Somerset's famous Glastonbury Festival is still being discussed by councillors. They're deciding whether or not to grant a public entertainment licence. The festival, the biggest of its kind in Europe, is threatened by concerns over crowd control and safety. The commander of Devonport Naval Base says the port will meet nuclear safety requirements when the first Trident nuclear submarine arrives in Plymouth for refit work next month. The assurance comes after a report from a government safety body which said the dockyard wouldn't be fully ready. One of Cornwall's eldest lifeboat stations is celebrating its 175th birthday. As Eleanor Parkinson reports, over the years, hundreds of men have worked on the Padstow lifeboat, saving countless lives.
The Padstow lifeboat came into being exactly 175 years ago to the day.
Since then, they've saved 620 lives. It's the oldest established lifeboat station in Cornwall. Lifeboats from there have been involved in some of the most dramatic rescues in Cornish history, including the loss of the sail training ship, the Maria Assumpter. Back in 1827, the first lifeboat was a four-oared rowing boat. She was later replaced by the slightly larger Arab. Everybody in the village would turn out to help launch her, and she was towed down to the beach by horses. Today it's more high-tech. Alan Tarby is the coxswain of the current vessel, the Jamesborough.
Nowhere near as hard as it was. It's a fairly safe option nowadays. I think when they went out years ago, there was a good chance they weren't coming back. Whereas when we go out, you know, we're 99% certain we're going to come back.
Hadso is due to get a new, faster lifeboat. And because she'll be bigger, a new boathouse and slipway will have to be built. But it's these brave volunteers that really keep the service going.
Let's hope the weather's better than in those pictures. Tomorrow, most of the region will have a cloudy and wet day with some heavy and prolonged rain. It'll clear to leave scattered showers, a mild and fresh day. That's it from the team. Back to Michael Burke in London. Good night.
And the main news again tonight, the Conservative leader Ian Duncan-Smith has launched a bitter attack on the government over the hospital treatment of a 94-year-old woman. He accused ministers of lying about the case of Rose Addis and smearing her family. Tony Blair has defended the doctors and nurses at the hospital. Newsnight starting now over on BBC Two, but from the 10 o'clock news, good night.
You can donate to the Disasters Emergency Committee Goma Crisis Appeal by writing to DEC Goma Crisis Appeal, PO Box 999, London, EC3A 3AA, or call 0870 60 60 900, or visit the website at dec.org.uk.
Good evening. There's some snow on the way for some of us in the next 24 hours, the highest risk for Scotland and Northern England. Most of that will be on the hills, but some will fall to lower levels too. There could be several hours of snow in some places, with drifting in the strong or gale force wind. And even before that arrives, there could be some ice on untreated surfaces in northern and eastern Britain, as temperatures drop to between minus 2 and even minus 5 degrees. But all the while, cloud and rain will be spilling in from the southwest by the end of the night. It's going to be rainy across Northern Ireland, Western England and Wales. Sleet and snow over the high ground, and all of that is going to transfer towards the northeast through the day. A significant chance of snow for Scotland and Northern England. And then that's going to turn to rain as milder weather moves in from the southwest. But there could be more than 10 centimetres of snow over the high ground of Scotland. Even in Glasgow and Edinburgh, there could be between 2 and 5 centimetres of snow. And it looks like that could fall at the wrong time. It could well fall in tomorrow morning's rush hour, making for some really nasty conditions on the roads. Then that snow will transfer into northern Scotland, and it's going to turn to rain down towards the southwest. Now that wind will drift the snow, it's also going to make it feel bitter. The wind chill temperature tomorrow around minus 10 to minus 12 in parts of Scotland. And for the rest of us, well, it looks like it's going to be a wet and windy day. Any sleet and snow turning to rain as the milder weather moves in, and eventually it'll brighten up across Northern Ireland, across Wales, Devon and Cornwall, with just a few showers. Now it is going to feel cold in Northern England, temperatures not too bad further south at 9 to 11 degrees, but it's not going to feel that good because of the strength of that southerly wind. Now, as the temperatures rise, any snow that's lying is likely to thaw. Couple that with all the rain we're expecting in the next few days, and there could well be some more flood warnings in the next few days. Already, we've got 4 in Scotland and 1 in Leicestershire. The floodline number, if you're at all worried, 0845 988 1188. And the unsettled theme really does continue through the weekend. That low pressure still around, weather fronts moving in, tightly packed isobars, it's also going to be windy. And most places will be mild, although the cold air will never be too far away from northern Scotland. Here there could be some more snow, but for the rest of us, one pulse of rain will move in during Saturday. Some drier weather for a time on Sunday before the next batch of wet and windy weather moves in from the southwest. And things aren't going to change an awful lot as we head into the new week. Bye-bye.
Born to a family of samurai, he brought Japanese cinema to a worldwide audience and inspired some of Hollywood's finest moments. A retrospective of Akira Kurosawa's finest films begins with an arena profile featuring exclusive interviews and unseen footage. Kurosawa season starts Saturday from 9 on BBC Knowledge.
For information on how to get BBC Knowledge, call us on 08700 100 789 or go online at bbc.co.uk/digital.
It's a world that has no limits. You can just go wild in your fantasy.
Princess Diana, Madonna, Elizabeth Hurley, Posh Spice.
He sees me sexier than other people.
Naomi Campbell, Meg Ryan, Catherine Zeta-Jones, Janet Jackson.
He always draws something out of me that other people don't.
Vogue, Versace, Gucci, Burberry, Lacroix, Valentino, Paul Smith, Ralph Lauren, Calvin Klein.
Discover the man behind the lens. Mario Testino, Diana's favourite photographer. Wednesday at 10:35 on BBC One.
And now on BBC One, it's Question Time.
Tonight on Question Time, the Government Chief Whip, Hilary Armstrong, John Bercow, Shadow Chief Secretary to the Treasury, broadcaster and author Muriel Gray, Dr. Tom Shakespeare, genetics expert and campaigner for disabled people, and the Reverend Sandy Miller, founder of the charismatic Christian Alpha Course, which now operates in over 130 countries. Thanks so much. So it's Sunderland tonight, and good to be here. And I think it's the first time Question Time's actually been to Sunderland, so it's a treat for us. And as ever, the panel don't know the questions that are going to be put, only I and the questioner. And the first questioner is Pam Wortley, who is a GP. Pam.
Does the Rose Addis case indicate that the health service is in terminal decline, or that the politicians will go to any length to score a point?
Muriel Gray.
A bit of both. I wouldn't think that it's terminal decline.